Yeah, it's time to noontime prayer. I brought the adult Bible study guide of the last quarter of 2024. It has 13 lessons. Today's the lesson A. Yeah, I'm gonna show you this content of this the fourth quarter. The title is the themes in the Gospel of John. Yeah, lesson one, signs that point to the way, two, signs of divinity, the backstory, three, the prologue, four, witness of Christ as the Messiah, five, the testimony of the Samaritans, six, more testimonies about Jesus, seven, blessed are those who believe, eight, fulfilling all the testament prophecies. Nine, the source of life. Ten, the way, the truth, and the life. 11, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. 12, the hour of glory, the cross, and resurrection. 13, epilogue, or knowing Jesus and his word. So let's go to the lesson eight, fulfilling all the testament. Today is the Wednesday, and gonna go Thursday, but read for this week's studies, usually John 5, 17, 20, 36, 2 through 40, 46, 47, John 13, 18, John 17, 12, Jeremiah 2, 13, Zechariah 9, 9, John 8, 12 through 30. The memory text comes from the John Book of John 5:36, but I have a greater witness than John's for the works which the Father has given me to finish. The very works that I do bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. Yeah, and just Sunday signs, works, and wonders. And Monday, the authoritative role of scripture. But Sunday, there are usually about John 5, 17, 20, 36 through 38. How can we protect ourselves from having the kind of hearts we see among these religious leaders? In what ways might we be fighting against the work of God in our own lives? And Monday part, the authoritative role of scripture, and 5:39, 40, 46, 47, what do they teach us about Jesus' attitude toward the authority of scripture? And John 13, 18, John 17, 12, and 19, 24, and 28, and 36, what do they teach about the authority of scripture as understood by Jesus and John? What should this tell us about the crucial role our scripture must have for our faith as well? And what are the forces today that either subtly or openly work to undermine our faith in the authority of the Bible? Bring your answer to class on Sabbath and Tuesday. All the Testament prophecies of Jesus. They are part one, and we're gonna compare how are the following New Testament and Old Testament passages linked. That is, how does the New Testament use these texts to bear witness to Jesus? John 1:23 and Isaiah 43 and John 2:16-17 Psalm, the book of Psalm 69:9 and John 7:38, Jeremiah 2:13 and John 19:36, Numbers 9:12. So not just John, but Peter, Paul, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and all the New Testament writers under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, time and again stress how Jesus of Nazareth's life, death, resurrection, and ascension to the throne of God are all fulfillments of the Old Testament prophecies. And today, Wednesday, Old Testament prophecies of Jesus part 2. Jesus said to the religious leaders, you search the scriptures for in them. You think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me. John 5:39. What an incredible claim to make about himself. Estimates vary, but some scholars argue that Jesus of Nazareth fulfilled the hundreds of Old Testament prophecies. Whatever the amount, the odds against one man's fulfilling even a few of them, much less them all, are staggering. Every now and then someone will use an image like this. Imagine filling an area the size of Texas, size of Texas, with the coins 2 feet high, and painting one coin pink and then mixing them all up. Then give a blindfolded person on one chance to pick the pink coin. What are the odds that with one pick he or she would get the pink one? No question, Christ's birth, life, and death were predicted by the Old Testament, stunning evidence of his identity as the expected Messiah. Join points to these Old Testament texts again and again to make that very point about who Jesus was, and also why we should believe in him and accept the salvation he offers. What do each of the following passages from John's Gospel reveal about Jesus as a fulfillment of Messianic prophecy? Go to John 12:13, Psalm 118:26, and John 12:14-15, Zechariah 9:9, John 13:18, Psalm 41:9, John 19:37, Zechariah 12:10, Zechariah 13:6. So how firmly grounded are you in what you believe? If someone were to challenge you on why you believe in Jesus as the Messiah, what answers could you give? Where would you go, and why, to help define that faith? Yeah. We're going to compare with this and go to Thursday part. There are John 12. John 13. Yeah, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. And if you go to the And 12:14-15. So then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, and fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. Yeah, there are exactly Zechariah 9:9 and John 13:18. Yeah, I do not speak concerning all of you. I know whom I have chosen, but the scripture may be fulfilled. He who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. And go there, 100, Psalm 41, 9, and 1937, John 1937. And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling us the truth, so that you may believe. It's going to Zechariah 12:10 and 13:6. Let's go Zechariah. Zechariah 12:10. Yeah. And I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and the supplication that they will look on me whom they have pierced. They will mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and grieve for him as one grieves for a firstborn. And for 13:6 here, and someone will say to him, what are these wounds in your hands? Then he will answer, those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends. Yeah, and let's go to the Thursday part from Venice. In our study of John so far, we've seen that John shows how Jesus indeed is the promised Messiah, the great hope that the Jewish people had been longing for. And yet many of the religious leaders, the spiritual guides of the people, were his biggest enemies instead. Why? Read John 8:12 through 30. What is the dynamic here between Jesus and three religious leaders? Which texts best explain why many rejected him? Jesus says that they know neither him nor the Father. John 8:19. They should have known both, but these men were self-deceived. They were so caught up in their own traditions and philosophies that even with Jesus right before them, doing all the things that he did and saying the things that he said, or powerful revelations of the Father, they still rejected him. Second, Jesus says to them, you are from Venus, John 8:23. In other words, however religious they might be, these were not spiritual godly men. They had a form of godliness. 2 Timothy 3:5, but that was all. They had outward piety, but inward disbelief. Yeah, this was nothing new. Inasmuch as these people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the commandment of men. Isaiah 29:13. This very concept is echoed by Jesus centuries later when he said, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Mark 7:7, their human teachings, their human commandments were of this world. John 8:23, and as Jesus then said, I am not of this world. John 8:23, it was bad enough that these men had been deceiving themselves. The tragedy was made worse because they also led others astray, even though, interestingly, enough John wrote that as a result of the exchange depicted in these verses, many believed in him, John 8:13. Thus, even despite bad leadership, many Jews were able to get beyond it and see for themselves who Jesus was. What lessons do you draw from Jesus' exchange with the religious leaders? How can we be from above and not from beneath? And how can we know the difference? Yeah, let's go to read John 8:12 through 13. 8:12 through 8. 8:12 through 13. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. 13. The Pharisees therefore said to him, You bear witness of yourself. Your witness is not true. Jesus answered and said to them, Even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true. For I know where I came from and where I am going. But you do not know where I came from and where I am going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. And yet if I do judge, my judgment is true. For I am not alone, but I am with the Father who sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. And then said to him, Where is your Father? Jesus answered, You know neither me nor my Father. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. These words Jesus spoke in the treasury as the taught in the temple, and no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come. Then Jesus said to them again, I'm going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. So the Jews said, will he kill himself? Because he says, where I go, you cannot come. Yeah. And he said to them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. Amen. Yeah. Let's pray. Let's pray. Voice, Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Yeah. May God bless all of you. Amen.